just an honor to be here today to present about active surveillance and our UCSF experience. So I'm just going to get right into it. So what is active surveillance? To introduce the topic, I want to give a little bit of background. So in the 1980s, PSA testing led to significant increases in the detection of prostate cancer. Here on this graph to the left, you have the incidence of prostate cancer diagnoses over time. And if you notice that after sort of the 1980 period, you have a significant spike in the number of diagnoses for prostate cancer. Before the 2000s, any man that was diagnosed with prostate cancer was highly likely to be treated with definitive therapy, so surgery, prostatectomy, or radiation therapy, almost irrespective of risk stratification group, which was very underdeveloped at that time. Active surveillance really just came about as a response to concerns about overtreatment. You know, what I will say is UCSF for the longest time was an early adopter in the field, has been a pioneer in many of the advances made in the field, and continues to do research on this topic to this day. So as mentioned previously by Dr. Washington, active surveillance seeks to avoid or delay the costs of treatment without compromising the ability for cure. And the way we do that is through accurate monitoring. We have a scheduled armamentarium of tools that we use. We have blood testing, the PSA test, as we have described, imaging with prostate MRI, tissue sampling with prostate biopsies, and genomic testing, which can be blood-based, urine-based, or tissue-based. And so, as Dr. Washington mentioned, active surveillance is, in the end, about timing. And the question we always ask ourselves when we see an active surveillance patient in our clinic is, does this patient's prostate cancer need to be treated right now? So to just talk about a typical schedule, this is a typical schedule for the typical patient. We do a PSA blood test roughly every 6 months. We get MRI imaging roughly every 18 months and a targeted biopsy. So through MRI or through transrectal ultrasound guided prostate biopsy every 2 years or so. We include genomic testing. Decipher is used in almost all of our patients right now at UCSF. And, you know, what we wanted to stress is that here at UCSF, active surveillance is tailored to the individual patient. It's a shared decision-making conversation between the providers and the patients. And, you know, just as an example, if we have a patient that comes into clinic with a lower risk, stable prostate cancer, has been on active surveillance for a long time, this patient may benefit from less aggressive surveillance. Instead of every 2 years for their biopsy, they may go to every 3 years. And this is an ongoing process and an ongoing conversation that we have every day with our patients. So to talk a little bit about candidacy for active surveillance, I'm just gonna throw up this slide here with all the available treatment options for prostate cancer. We have great sessions coming up dedicated to each of these topics: focal therapy, surgery, radiation therapy, systemic therapy. You know, I'm talking here about active surveillance, which is sort of the farthest on the left here for the less aggressive cancers. And to just talk about how these are in the guidelines, active surveillance is the preferred management strategy for low-risk prostate cancer. And it also is an option in select intermediate-risk prostate cancer patients. And this is endorsed by all of our major guidelines, the AUA, the EAU, and the NCCN. So when we think about risk stratification for prostate cancer, the easiest way to think about it is patients can be stratified into low risk, intermediate risk, or high risk. And other groups take it further. The AUA, for example, further subdivides intermediate risk into favorable intermediate and unfavorable intermediate risk categories. And the NCCN takes that even one step further, and they further subdivide low risk and high risk categories as well. As I mentioned previously, here in red is the sort of preferred management. So this is all the low risk prostate cancer patients. The preferred management strategy is active surveillance. And then here in orange, these patients with favorable intermediate risk, it is an option, and that is an area of shared decision-making that is important in discussions with your physician. To talk about what determines whether a patient is low, intermediate, or high risk, we look at many different things. So the PSA that we've talked about extensively, that is a big component of many of these risk stratification groups. We have something called the PSA density, which looks at the PSA test value and how big your prostate gland is. And depending on what that number is, you may be further stratified into lower or intermediate risk. We have the volume of prostate cancer. So out of the 12 or 16 biopsies that you had, how many of those cores were positive for prostate cancer? What percentage of each core had a high amount of prostate cancer or not? And then stage is sort of a sense of how extensive is your prostate cancer. So the way we used to do it is through the urologist handshake or the digital rectal exam. Currently, we also use imaging extensively to also make a call about stage. And then grade, which is how that prostate cancer looks under the microscope as diagnosed by our pathologist colleagues. We also look at genomics. We look at age and the overall health of the patient. We look at ethnicity, as certain ethnic groups are more likely to have more aggressive or less aggressive disease. We look at patient and family preferences. And one thing I didn't include on here is family history of prostate cancer. So how are we doing as an institution here at UCSF? You know, happy to report that for low-risk patients that come into our clinics at UCSF, our uptake for active surveillance is nearly 100%. You know, I'm never going to say it's exactly 100%, but it is very close. And, you know, this is just a graph from our urologic outcomes database, just showing the number of patients we are seeing in clinic now who are getting surgery over being treated with active surveillance. And in navy blue, the proportion of patients that we're seeing in the clinics that are being managed with active surveillance is increasing year after year. So definitely uptake in our clinics nationally. And this is a great paper by Dr. Cooperberg, where he showed that uptake nationally is significantly increasing in 2021 for low-risk prostate cancer patients. That number is about 60%, which is up from 27% in 2014. You know, we'd love to see this be even higher and as close to 100% as possible, but there's still work to be done. To talk a little bit about outcomes, this was a paper that we published in the Journal of Urology in 2020 in our active surveillance cohort here at UCSF, roughly 1,500 patients with a median follow-up of 77 months. 90% of these patients were with low-grade and low-risk disease. And just to talk about some of these survival metrics, I won't go into a ton of detail, but upgrade-free survival was 40%, the main takeaway being that progression or upgrade of a patient's prostate cancer is very common while on active surveillance. Treatment-free survival was 59%, and this means that roughly 40% of the patients that do have progression of disease, 40% of the patients in the cohort ended up going on to require some other form of treatment later on. Metastasis-free survival was 99%, and prostate cancer-specific survival was 99%. And the takeaway from that is essentially that in our active surveillance cohorts, metastasis and mortality from prostate cancer is just very, very low for these patients that we've selected to be on active surveillance. So for the last few minutes that I have here, I want to talk a little bit about what we have been doing at UCSF with all of the active surveillance data that we have available and talk a little bit about our extensive outcomes database. So the urologic outcomes database at UCSF, which I've alluded to a few times in this presentation already, this was pioneered by our own Dr. Carroll here. And this is an institutional database that has outcomes data for over 9,000 prostate cancer patients who have agreed to participate in research. It is one of the largest outcomes databases for prostate cancer in the world, and it's only made possible by you, our patients. And you know, it has led to many seminal contributions into the field of prostate cancer and has really just transformed active surveillance and continues to do so year after year. Just to mention briefly, and again, won't go into detail for all these papers, but in the past two decades alone, from this urologic outcomes database, we've published extensively on active surveillance. There are many different sort of types of projects that we've done. Many of these can be found on our website, but I won't go into them into much detail. What I will do, just for the sake of explanation, is I'll pick four projects that we did over the recent years, asking a really important clinical question in the field of active surveillance and sort of how we address that using our database. So one question we get, and this was published in the Journal of Clinical Oncology in 2017, was, is active surveillance safe in younger men? And the rationale for this project is really that younger patients who are started on an active surveillance will have to be on active surveillance for a long period of time and may need a definitive treatment down the line. And so to look at this project, we looked at 1,400 patients in our cohort that met criteria. We subdivided based on age, and we found that younger age was actually associated with a lower risk of upgraded pathology after biopsy on active surveillance and progression of disease. We found that there was no significant association between younger age and time to treatment or recurrence outcomes after surgery. And, you know, just to make things simple here, we do believe that younger men can benefit from active surveillance, and this concern about being on active surveillance for a long period of time is overstated. Let me come back to that after, just for the sake of time. I'll get to your question as the first question. Another topic of interest, and this was published in European Urology by Dr. Chu, one of our new faculty and our team. And the question here was, can prostate MRI be used instead of prostate biopsy? You know, patients hate prostate biopsies. We know that. You guys know that. Prostate MRI has been a huge advance in the field of detecting significant prostate cancer. We've been able to use it to predict or sort of associate with outcomes after active surveillance. And what we did was we looked at 400 patients with low-grade disease, and we found that, unfortunately, 22% of our patients that had a negative prostate MRI ended up having upgraded disease on subsequent biopsy. And this is a really important study. And, you know, our takeaway from that is, at least in our hands, MRI should not replace prostate biopsies for patients on active surveillance. More recently, we published this in the Journal of Urology recently, the question being, there are some patients that have low-grade cancer, so 3+3 disease. However, they have 3+3 disease all throughout their prostate. And typically, or traditionally, urologists would see this kind of patient and throw them in a higher risk category, and these patients would end up getting treatment, whether that's surgery or radiation. And so we looked at this on an institution level. We had 1,000 patients who were eligible with low-grade disease that ended up getting surgery just because that was the nature of the times. We found that increased tumor volume based on the number of cores that were positive on their biopsy was not associated with most important prostate cancer outcomes, such as having a major biopsy upgrade or having recurrence after surgery. And, you know, our takeaway from this study really is that this data does suggest safety of active surveillance in patients with high volume but low grade prostate cancer. And most recently, we published this in European Urology Oncology in December of this year. We asked the question, and this is a question we get a lot, is, you know, uptake of active surveillance is limited by fear that the time that patients spend on active surveillance kind of delays them getting the treatment that they need. And so the way that we looked at that in our cohort is we had 1,300 patients who ended up undergoing surgery at various time points. We had patients who had 3+4 disease who underwent initial prostatectomy or initial surgery. And we had patients who were on a period of active surveillance for years who upgraded and eventually got surgery. And then we had patients who upgraded, waited over 12 months, and then got their surgery after 12 months. And we looked at how those patients did. And overall, we found that the timing of definitive surgery, whether upfront or delayed or even further delayed, actually was not associated with risk of recurrence after surgery. And so to us, you know, the takeaway from this is that because there were similar recurrence outcomes between upfront and delayed surgery, it really does support the safety of active surveillance, and that this delay really we thought was overstated. So in conclusion, active surveillance is the preferred form of treatment of men with low risk and select patients with favorable intermediate risk. At UCSF, we tailor active surveillance to the individual patient, and it's a shared decision-making conversation. Uptake has significantly increased for active surveillance over the years nationally, but there is certainly still work to do. And patient participation is crucial for high impact novel research about active surveillance, and that new technology, which we'll be talking about in the talks to come, has and will continue to transform the field. And with that, I'd like to just thank the team here, Prostate Cancer Group, obviously Dr. Carroll, my mentor, Janet, our amazing statistician, Dr. Washington, who helped me with some of these slides, Dr. Cooperberg, who has contributed to, you know, to the field in many, many ways, and to all of the rest of the team. So thank you so much.